is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross.
Hands together.
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down. Done for me.
Well, good morning, everybody. So glad you're here. My name is David, and just want to welcome you to Valley Harvest this morning, and let's just continue to worship.
Grace, what have you done? Murder for me on that cross, accused in absence of wrong, my sin washed away in your blood. Too much to make sense of it all. I know that your love breaks my fall. Scandal of grace, you died in my place, so my soul will live. Oh, to be like you, give all I have just to know you, Jesus. dead as my sin. The cross has taught me to live. Mercy, my heart now to sing.
Today in its troubles,
today and its troubles shall come. Know that your strength is enough.
Good morning. My name is Michelle Linares, and I am the Children's Director here at Valley Harvest. And it's an exciting day today. It's an exciting day today. You know what day it is? Sunday. Well, today is a new beginning for Valley Harvest, and I'm here coming as the Children's Director and also as a member of the search committee. Sounds really important. We just prayed and read the Bible. We're bringing today to our new family, we're joining Ryan and Amber. I'm going to have them come up. And Peyton and Titus and Collins. In case you haven't met them already, Ryan is our new next generation pastor. Diapers to degrees. And if you're sitting there thinking, oh, I don't have to do anything now, they got him. No, he needs you to reach the community of Chachilla. So to start us out, I wanted to read a little bit from the book of James. I know you're thinking the book of James, that's what everybody's thinking. But from chapter 1, it says, "Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow, for when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. So I come before you to tell you that these people are not perfect and complete. They need God, and they need you. But most importantly, I come to tell you that you are not perfect either. Because God has a job for us to do as a family. This community needs God, needs salvation, and needs a relationship to sustain their life while they're here waiting for eternity. I want to thank Amber and Ryan for taking the call. As the search committee, something that we said all the time is, clear the path, Lord, clear the path. God, you know. We don't want who David wants. We don't want who Michelle wants. We don't want who Carolyn wants or Tyler wants or Chrissy or Sophia or any of what you people want. We want what you want. And even when we talked to Ryan early on, he's like, whatever God's will is, let it be. So I'm calling on you as a congregation to make a promise right now to support him in prayer, to come alongside him in worship, and to serve a community that God loves. Okay? And we are sharing blessings today. Since you've decided to bless us with your presence, we've decided to bless your pantry with some gifts. Your family wanted you to have a little food while you prepare to serve here at Valley Harvest. And so we want to thank you. And you know what? Titus and Peyton and Collins, we're so happy you're here. We're so happy for you to be a part of our family, and Amber and Ryan. And then I'm going to go to a little bit more in James. The better part that everybody wants to hear. Whatever is good and perfect is a gift coming down to us from God, our Father, who created all the lights in the heaven. He never changes or casts a shifting shadow. He chose to give birth to us by giving us his true word. And we, out of all creation, became his prized possessions. God needs to grow in Chowchilla. And as a family, a church family, this is our plan to do it. We need prayer and we need support. And Lord, I beg that God gives you everything you need to lift him up and let him be used like you need to be used. So join me in praying. If you want to lay hands on them, you want to come and pray with them, you want to stand up, hold hands with someone you know, you don't know, we need to start this out the way it began. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for all that you are, Lord. I thank you for your power, and I thank you that in this process that you clearly revealed to us your will for Ryan and Amber here in Chowchilla. Lord, I know that it's not going to be easy, Lord, to share the message. There are so many distractions in this world, Lord, but I know what you want for Chowchilla, and I beg you, Lord, to put blessings upon this congregation, Lord. And on Ryan and Amber, I pray, Lord, for their strength and for their joy and, Lord, for endurance as we spread the gospel, Lord. But most of all, I pray that you move all these people out of your way, that you become more and more and more, and we become less and less, Lord. And I just thank you in advance for all the work that you're going to allow us to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So we're going to be singing a new song this morning, and I just wanted to talk about it real quick. It's called Open Heaven, and it's kind of a song that really speaks to me. It's all about the Holy Spirit, and there can be times in my life when I feel like my sin keeps me from talking to God, from calling the name of Jesus. And sometimes, in those times, the Holy Spirit intercedes for me. You know, the Holy Spirit speaks to God for me when I feel like I cannot do it. And this song kind of reflects that, you know, the Holy Spirit falling like a flood, burning like a fire in our soul, just being a presence inside of us that intercedes for us. So I just wanted to practice it a couple times before we jump into the song. Whenever you feel comfortable, just jump on in. Holy Spirit, rain, falling like a flood. Break upon my praise as I sing of your love. Holy Spirit, fire, burn within my soul as I call on your name. You guys kind of get it a little bit? Let's do it one more time.
Holy Spirit, rain, falling like a flood. Break upon my sing of your love. Holy Spirit, fire, burn within my soul as I call on your name.
in this time, if you just want to reflect on the words, you have every right to do that. If you want to sing along, I encourage you to. Let's just take this moment in this song and just reflect on the Holy Spirit.
Signs and wonders from above. When you poured out your Spirit on the old and the young, in the power of your presence,
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, rain falling like a flood, break upon my praise as I sing of your love. Holy Spirit, fire burning in my soul as I call on your name. As I call on your name. Stand in your presence, revelations of your love. As I look to the heavens, Holy Spirit, rain falling like a flood, break upon my as I sing of your love. Holy Spirit, fire burns within my soul as I call on your name. As I call on your name. As I call on your name. Thank you.
Holy Spirit.
Come, Holy Spirit, burn like a fire, all consuming, consuming. Here in your presence, Lord, I surrender to your glory, to your glory.
Holy Spirit, rain, falling like a flood, break upon my praise as I sing of your love. Holy Spirit, fire, burn within my soul as I call on your name. Let's sing as I call on your name.
As I call on your name. As I call on your name,
Jesus.
As I call on your name,
Jesus.
As I call on your name,
Jesus.
As I call on.
God, we call on your name, that even in times when we feel like our sin gets in the way of being able to communicate with you, God, that the Holy Spirit intercedes for us and speaks on our behalf. Even when we do not have words, the Holy Spirit groans with inside of us. We just thank you for that gift that you've given us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning, and I hope you know that God is available to you should you need him. But I find that God always comes to us in our greatest need, doesn't he? God always comes to us in our greatest need. You can turn your Bibles to Genesis chapter 18 today. I've entitled the message, God Offers His Friendship. Last week we were looking at Genesis chapter 17, where God gave Abraham, got to get my figures right there, God gave Abraham this command, this sign that was supposed to represent this covenant relationship between him and God. And it was a sign of circumcision, and it was an external mark, and we were talking about, you know, identifying with God. And today we're going to see that God comes to Abraham in a special way because he's Abraham's friend. And if you've identified as a follower of Jesus, if you're known as his, then there should be things in our life that identify us as his. And so God comes to Abraham in a very special way in our text today. And I began to think, you know, what if God was to show up here? I mean, what if God came to Chowchilla in a way that was absolutely so undeniable? I mean, do you think people would rave about that in our small town? Because, you know, one thing I find, I know that small towns go big when a superstar visits their community. If you remember a couple years ago, during homecoming in Kerman, thousands gathered at their high school to celebrate their longstanding tradition of homecoming, but it was different that year with a unique theme because they invited Tom Hanks to come. And the high school did a lot of work. And, you know, so they used Tom Hanks movies as class themes, and they even invited Tom Hanks to join them. He had to decline because he was working on a project. But he did the next best thing, and he sent them a 7-minute video. And so to screaming cheers from eager students, the short film debuted on an inflatable screen set up in the middle of the football field, and Hanks gave students a backstage pass to the everyday life of an actor. And the high school leadership coordinator, David Bockholden, said, "When you look back on this week from now, a month from now, a year from now, you're really going to realize how special what we did here was. We're a small town in the middle of nowhere, California, and because we came together as a community, we were able to gain the attention of the world's largest popular actor. The former principal, you know, noted all the hard work they had did, and Jeremy Backholden once again said, the atmosphere is crazy. I mean, we had a blimp out here. We had all kinds of stuff. It brought tears to my eyes. And so, you know, Kerman went crazy for the idea that Tom Hanks, you know, recognized their community. And yet we serve a God who is greater than Tom Hanks. I mean, we have the God who gave Tom Hanks breath. We serve the God that made everything. He spoke, and the universe is leapt into existence. We serve the most famous God, the one who sent his son, Jesus, to die on a cross. He promises to be here with us now. And we're going to read about this story about where he comes to visit Abraham. Would you stand with me as I read verse 1 through 8? And the Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre, as he sat at the door of his tent in the heat of the day. He lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, three men were standing in front of him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them and bowed himself to the earth and said, O Lord, if I have found favor in your sight, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourself under the tree while I bring a morsel of bread that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant. So they said, do as you have said. And Abraham went quickly into the tent to Sarah and said, quick, three seahs of fine flour, knead it, make cakes. And Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to a young man who prepared it quickly. And then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared, and set it before them, and he stood before them, and he stood by them under the tree while they ate. Now, God, I pray that you would help us in our cold, dead, hard estate to recognize your presence when it comes. And that our hearts would be lit afire as we've asked that your Holy Spirit you'd burn in us as we sang. We pray that you would once again ignite our hearts with the joy of knowing you. In your name I pray, Jesus, amen. You may be seated. God offers his friendship to you, just like he's offered his friendship here to Abraham. And the first thing I want you to note is that Abraham welcomes the presence of God. And this is a key important factor when revivals began out. When a revival began, it is a work that God does, and hearts are ready to receive it. So God is offering you and I his friendship. And he offers his friendship to those who welcome his presence. Notice that Abraham here in our story is anxious to invite the Lord into his home. We see that it's the heat of the day. He's in his tent, and when he sees these three men standing in front of him, he runs to greet them. He bows before them. He invites them in. He does the hard work of preparing a meal before them. He is honored and anxious to have them in his home. So who are these three men? Well, I'm going to submit to you that these three men are the Lord and two of his angels. Now, where do I get that? You'll notice as we go on throughout the story in the conversation that Abraham keeps referring to at least one of these men as the Lord. Now, this is the covenant name of Yahweh. This is the name of God. And he keeps referring to one of them as the Lord. And then when you get to chapter 19, they depart, and two of them, called angels, go to the city of Sodom because they have business to take care of there. So this is none other than a pre-incarnate appearance. This means a pre-Jesus, pre-zero AD appearance of the Lord Jesus. This is the Lord Jesus coming to meet Abraham. Abraham, Jesus came to Abraham's home, and he's excited, and so he breaks open the hospitality. He notices he runs out there in the heat of the day, and he prepares this meal. And that says a lot about him because, you know, in ancient Near Eastern culture, the level of hospitality that you gave somebody said a lot about the way you felt about them. You know, you might encounter, you hear the term Southern hospitality, and the South is supposed to be known, and there's an ongoing debate about whether it's really as hospitable as maybe it was at one point in time, but, you know, that term means that there's this kind of hospitality that's supposed to come to you when you're in the South or known for that. Well, it's the same thing here. It's the same thing in this story, and so Abraham breaks open the hospitality and says, nothing but the best. The king is coming. This is royalty coming. This is someone far better than any president, far better than any king. And so he offers this hospitality. It says a lot about his respect for this visitor. Do you realize the level of hospitality you give to people when they come into your home says a lot about your level of respect for them? We all have different levels of friendships, don't we? You know, we have acquaintances. Those are people we might know about. Don't really know them real well, you know, just kind of see them around. And there are acquaintances. And we all have, you know, casual friends, people that we don't necessarily invite to our house or hang out with. But if we see them at a social event, say a baseball game or maybe even at church, we'll stop and have a conversation with them. We know them by name. We'll have a conversation with their casual friends. And then we have another level of friendship we call close friends, someone whom, you know, we will invite to our home, and we'll spend time with them more than just at social gatherings. But some of us have been privileged to have best friends, haven't we? Some of us have been privileged to have those people that, man, you could call that person my twin because we think alike. Those are some special friendships. They're tight, right? I thought about the term family, but I know that family, sometimes some people, you know, don't use the term family in such a positive light, but, you know, my wife reminded me of Lilo and Stitch, and they called it Ohana, right? What kind of hospitality are you willing to give God? Speaks a lot about your level of friendship and respect for him. Notice God comes to Abraham in the hardest part and the hottest part of the day. And what does Abraham do? It says in verse 1 that he runs to meet him. Now, in ancient Near Eastern culture, you know, the hot part of the day, especially for a shepherd, that would have been the part of the day that if you're going to take a break, you take the break. It's hot. And you work, you know, they didn't have air conditioning, you know. They didn't have solar panels, Dennis. They didn't have that, you know. What are they going to do? I mean, then you have PG&E. I mean, we sit there and cry about, you know, our large bills, but thank God we have air conditioners to keep us cool. This is the heat of the day, and Abraham runs out to meet him to do the hardest, during the hottest part of the day to do this, to greet them. And why? It's because he is anxious to invite them into his home. And so he goes and he says, Sarah, please make some cakes. This is, you know, this bread. And he goes to one of his servants and he picks the goat out. He says, get the best goat. Get the best goat. You know, we have a special guest here. And my question for you is, are you a friend of God? God offers you his friendship, but are you willing to be his friend? And what kind of friend are you allowing him to be to you? And what kind of friend are you being to him? Is God more your acquaintance? You know about him? You know the name God, Jesus, you know it. But you don't know him. Or is God more like your casual friend? You know, you go to church sometimes. You know, you're here maybe even once a month. You casually know who God is. You might call yourself a Christian. Or is God your close friend where, you know, you call on him when things are bad? When things are tough, you'll call on him. He's a close friend. You talk to him regularly because things in your life are regularly bad. Or is God that intimate best friend that you share your soul with? See, God comes to us regularly. And I find that the Lord often comes to us as a wayfaring stranger or as a hungry and a thirsty soul. God will come to us as a hopeless prisoner. Do you remember Jesus said in Matthew chapter 25, He told the story that the king will turn, will come to these people, and he will tell them, I was hungry and you didn't feed me. I was thirsty and you didn't give me a drink. And I was a stranger and you didn't invite me into your home. I was naked and you didn't clothe me. I was sick and in prison and you didn't even visit me. And they're going to say, when did we do this to you, Lord? He's going to say, in that you did not do it to the least of these, you did not do it to me. See, God comes to visit us in all kinds of different ways, doesn't he? And doesn't our Lord test us in this way? See, if he came in his splendor, we'd all run out to meet him, but we wouldn't really reveal our true character, would we? And so God comes to Abraham. Abraham runs out to meet him. And in verse 9, it says, they said to him, where is Sarah, your wife? And he said, she is in the tent. Notice the Lord said, I will surely return to you about this time, that time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son. Now, this is a problem. As Sarah listens in the tent, and behind him, in verse 11, Abraham and Sarah were old and advanced in years. The way of women had ceased with Sarah. In other words, she had already been through menopause. And so Sarah laughed to herself, saying, after I'm worn out, my Lord is old, shall I have pleasure? And the Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh and say, shall indeed I bear a child now that I'm old? Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you about this time next year, and Sarah will have a son. But Sarah denied it, saying, I did not laugh, for she was afraid. And he said, no, but you laughed. Now notice that Abraham presents this hospitality for God because he is excited for Jesus to come visit him. But as he presents that, I want you to note that God, in return, says, you're going to have a child. God, Abraham, the one thing you want is a child that I've been promising you, and guess what? It is going to happen, but now I'm going to tell you something else. It's going to happen next year. Now I've got a time frame for you. Next year, Sarah will have a child, and God is going to bless them with this gift. And I want you to note that Abraham cannot outgive God. He is trying to bless God, but God will not let Abraham outgive him. As he presents to Abraham that next year he will have this child. And because God is very careful to never leave himself indebted to anybody. You know, Jesus was very careful to pay for his entertainment, royally and divinely. If you remember, he uses Peter's fishing vessel and he gives it back, nearly submerged by the weight of fish he has driven into the nets. He sits down with friends to a country marriage feast and pays for the simple affair by jars brimming of water turned to wine. He used 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish, but the lad has an ample meal. He sends his prophets to lodge with a widow and provides meal and oil for both of them for many days. And Abraham was no loser by his ready hospitality, for as they sat at this meal, the Lord foretold that Sarah was going to give birth to a child. My friends, you cannot outgive God. You cannot make God owe you something. God will always respond back with a greater gift. That's who he is. And yet we see here in verse 10, Sarah struggles to believe this. It says that she's in her tent and she begins to laugh behind the door. And so she says, after I'm worn out in verse 12 and my Lord is old, shall I have this pleasure? Notice that she's struggling to believe God. Now, 25 years have passed since this promise was first made. 25 years is a long time. Day in, day out, she's waiting for this promise. And after a while, you just say, I'm being gullible. Am I being gullible? I mean, menopause was long gone, long time ago. I'm 90 years old. I'm going to have a child. Yeah. And her hopes get crushed enough to where she says, I'm not going to believe it. I'm not going to make myself vulnerable anymore. Don't do that to me. Don't do that to me. And perhaps, you know, she's even getting bitter. And maybe that's you. Perhaps you're struggling to believe God today because you've looked at the same set of circumstances playing out week after week, and it's leaving you to have this critical spirit to where you disbelieve God now. And so she says, yeah, whatever. And she's not even outside. And notice what the Lord does. The Lord calls her out. He says, "Why'd Sarah laugh, Abraham?" Notice he doesn't go to Sarah, he goes to Abraham. That's instructive for us. Remember that when Adam and Eve sinned in Genesis 3, who does God go to first? The husband. Husbands, you are to be responsible for your families. And God goes to Abraham, "Why'd she laugh?" Now, I can only imagine how Abraham is. This is Jesus sitting in front of him. If there's one time you want to, be on your best behavior, it's like, man, Jesus is here. And I can only imagine that this must have been a huge embarrassment to Abraham as Sarah laughs. I think that's instructive for us, isn't it? That God comes to Abraham and he says, why does Sarah laugh? And Abraham, has to go and ask Sarah about it. And she ends up denying it. But God says in verse 14, is anything too hard for the Lord? My question to you, is anything really too hard for God? It may seem too hard to us that God should keep his word, that he should convert that friend you've been praying for many years, that he should vindicate your character from the slanderous gossip that's trashed your reputation, or that he should keep your evil nature under control, casting down every thought, or to make your bitter self sweet and forgiving once again. But I'm telling you, it's not too hard for God. Nothing is too hard for God. And so God makes this point and he makes it abundantly clear. My question is, are you close enough friends with him to be on the same page? Are you his acquaintance? Are you just a casual friend to God? Maybe a close friend you called him when you're in trouble? Are you his intimate companion? Are you close enough friends with God to know that he can turn your less than desirable circumstances around on a whim? And perhaps you're still where you are at because he's testing you to see how long you'll keep trusting him. Well, in verse 16, it says the men, these three men, one of them was the Lord, set out from there. And they looked down towards Sodom, and Abraham went with them to set them on their way. And the Lord said, Shall I hide from Abraham what I'm about to do, seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him? For I have chosen him that he may command his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteous and justice, so that the Lord may bring Abraham what he has promised him. Notice God's concern for the family there. God's saying, I'm not going to hide these things from Abraham because I'm going to use Abraham. And my point in revealing things to Abraham is that I want him to instruct his family. You want God to reveal things to you? Are you ready to instruct your family in that way? And so we go on, and in verse 20, he says, then the Lord said, because the outcry, this is speaking to Abraham, because the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and their sin is very grave, I will go down to see what they've done altogether according to the outcry that has come to me. And if not, I will know. So the men turned from there and went towards Sodom. Abraham still stood before the Lord. So the Lord and these two men are separating, but Abraham is still with the Lord. And Abraham draws near and he says to the Lord, will you indeed sweep away the righteous with the wicked? Notice that Abraham is very concerned about the city Sodom. The city Sodom was known for its wickedness. And Abraham, is concerned about justice being done. He says, will you indeed sweep away the righteous with the wicked, as we're about to see? And I want you to see something about Abraham's character. He is becoming more and more like Jesus. The more time he spends as God's friend, the more he starts becoming like him. I don't know if any of you ever told this, but our moms tend to know who we've been hanging out with when we were teenagers, right? You come home different after hanging out with certain friends as a teenager, right? I've got teenagers. I know exactly what that's like. I know who you've been hanging out with. I can tell that to my boys, my wife particularly. You got this attitude thing going on, right? Well, the same thing is true with us with God. The more time we spend with God, the more we become like him. And God is a God of justice. And Abraham cares about justice now. And that's how friendship works. And God offers you his friendship. And he offers that friendship to those who plead for his justice. God cares about justice. And because Abraham is, you know, a man, even though this is a title tied to David, he's definitely a man who walks by faith with God. He's a man after God's own heart. Notice that he is entrusted with the knowledge of God's plan. God's saying, should I hide these things from Abraham? Why would he want to do that? Well, because if you recall, Abraham has a nephew who lives in the city of Sodom by the name of Lot. Abraham is always looking out for Lot's back. When they divided the land, Abraham gave Lot the first pick. Lot chose the finer piece of real estate down in Sodom and Gomorrah area, and Lot moves down there. If you remember in chapter 14, some kings came in, and Lot got taken away as a slave due to, you know, two kingships war with one another, and Abraham had to go rescue him. Abraham is always looking out for Lot's back, and God says, shall I hide this from Abraham? And Abraham says, and God doesn't. God reveals to Abraham what he is about to do. This says that Abraham is a prophet. Do you know what a prophet is? A prophet in the Bible is someone whom God reveals his will to. Now, it might be something in the future, or it might be right now. And this is the way God works. He always speaks to his prophets first. And Amos chapter 3, verse 7 says, indeed, the sovereign Lord never does anything until he reveals his plans to his servants, the prophet. And so God comes to him and says, Sodom and Gomorrah, their sins are stinking up to high heaven. And guess what? I'm going down and I'm going to check it out. Now, this is concerning because, you know, because Abraham knows what Sodom is like. And so now that he knows that God's going to go pay a visit, he has this burden. And my friends, when God gives you this special knowledge, it's oftentimes a burden to you and I, isn't it? It's a burden knowing what God's plans are in the future. For instance, we know from the Bible that Jesus is going to come back to the earth one day, and he's not coming back like a nice little cute little lamb. He's coming back like a lion. He's going to come back to the earth, and Peter says it's going to be fury. And it's going to be bad for a lot of our friends and people we love. And we don't like that, right? We don't like that God of wrath, but that God of grace and mercy is also the God of wrath. And it's a burden to know that, isn't it? It's a burden to know that many of the people we love are going to die and perish and go to hell and be eternally lost from God. That's a burden to know that. And so God reveals this to Abraham. And he's saying, you know, yeah, I've heard it. And guess what? If Sodom is like what I think, it's going to get ugly. You know, this question made me think, what is God saying about Chowchilla? If God is revealing to Abraham what he is going to do down in Sodom, what is God revealing to us and what he's going to do here in Chowchilla? I really can't say, in all honesty, for any specifics. One thing I know about our community is we have a small community. We're actually in the 93610 zip code. There's actually 15,700 residents that aren't incarcerated. So I'm taking the prison out, just so you know, right? That's not the city limits. That's the 93610 zip code. And, you know, we have a very low, compared to most places, we have a very low rate of violent crimes. There's so few, I'm not even going to report on it, although we do have a lot of burglaries, thefts, stolen vehicles, right? We have plenty of that. But I look back in 2010 at the census, and did you know that 47% of Chowchillians identify as non-religious? 47%. 12% identify with either Protestant or evangelical. We'd be considered evangelical. Sometimes evangelicals get lumped into Protestant Christianity. 12% identify as Protestant Christians and 38% identify as Catholic. Yet, if you have any knowledge of church attendance here in Chowchilla, and I know just about every pastor here, I've got a good idea, roughly 8% of Chowchilla darkens the door of any local church on any given Sunday. Roughly 8% of our community will come to church any given Sunday. Now, I know, I don't think we're like Sodom. You read ahead, you'll see how bad Sodom was. I don't think Chowchilla's like Sodom. But I'm telling you what, God cares about our city. And he cares about our people. And don't tell me that there's, you know, not people here to share the gospel with. You know, I find that Chowchilla's largely made up of de-churched people. You know what I'm talking about. People who had some kind of encounter with the church before, maybe used to go to church, but either they got rubbed the wrong way or they just are enslaved to sin, made some bad choices, or whatever their reason is, they just don't go. And if they do, there's plenty of them that might go once a month, and that's apparently the new national average regular. Most Americans think if you go to church once a month, you're a regular church attender. When I was growing up, you had to go to church at least every Sunday. I went to church two times on Sunday and on Wednesday. Chowchilla needs God. Our population is largely bitter towards God and bitter towards His church. And they need to see the presence of God at work in a body of Christ that is real, that is legitimate, that cares about them and not just about their attendance. My friends, is that not what God has called you and I to? And so God reveals this to Abraham that he's going to Sodom and it's probably going to be pretty bad. And so in verse 24, Abraham says, he's going to start bargaining with God. He says, suppose there are 50 righteous within the city. Suppose there's 50 righteous, God, will you then sweep away the place and not spare it for those 50 who are in it? Far be it from you to do such a thing, to put the righteous to death with the wicked so that the righteous fare as the wicked? Far be it from you. Shall not the judge of all the earth do what is just? And the Lord said, if I find 50 righteous people in this city, I'll spare the whole city for their sake. Now, note that in Abraham's day, in the ancient Near East, a large city would have consisted of about 1,000 people. So we'd be a mega city if we were in the ancient Near East. But smaller cities tend to be about around 100. That would make up about a small city. Can you imagine growing up in a city with just 100 people? Abraham is essentially saying, you know, if there's 50 people here, if that was a small city, it'd be roughly 50% of the population. And God says, you know what? I won't destroy it for that. What is Abraham doing here? He is burdened to intercede to God to prevail for the city. He's concerned that justice will be given on behalf of the righteous. Why is he so concerned about that? Why does he care about these people down in Sodom and Gomorrah? Well, number one, his nephew lives there. But I think it's more than just that. I think Abraham cares about this is because he's been hanging out with God. And friend, when you hang out with God, you start caring about the things that he cares about. Now, there are numerous occasions in Scripture where God will spare a whole people group because of a few righteous people living in it. Who knows? God might be sparing Chowchilla some vast judgment because of some righteous people living here. Certainly that would be you. You guys are just so righteous here today. Abraham noticed that he's concerned here, and he is concerned for his nephew. He's always having to rescue him, but he begins to work on God. And so God says, I won't do it for the sake of 50. Verse 27, Abraham speaks again. He says, I'm undertaken to speak again to you, Lord, but I know I'm dust and ashes. Suppose there's 5 less there. Will you destroy the whole city for a lack of 5? And God says, I won't do it for 45. And verse 29, he says again, he brings it down to 40. And you see, God says, I won't do it again. And Abraham's pushing the Lord's buttons here because he's whittling them down until he gets them all the way down to 10. And God says, if there's 10 righteous people there in the city, I won't do it. What I want you to note here is that Abraham is very concerned for the people. He cares about justice. And if you are a friend of God here today, you care about Chowchilla. You care about the lost people in our community that will die and perish for eternity. You care about them because they're people and you love them and your heart has changed and you care about them because Jesus died for them. He died for the lost and he loves the lost. You care about them if you're a friend of God. But if you're just his acquaintance, you're not so concerned. If you're just a casual friend, you see the need, but maybe it's not a big deal to you. My friends, if you are close to God, you will care about the lost people in our community because Jesus died for the lost and he loves the lost. And my friends, my question for you is, are you a friend of Jesus or are you just his acquaintance? Do you pray for the lost here in our community? My question is very legitimate, isn't it? You know, I look out here and I'm thankful for everyone that's here, and I'm not about just filling this house up. You know what? I pray that God would fill Cornerstone, Family Worship Center, you know, 4th and Orange, my brothers at Free Will Baptist and others. I don't mean leave anyone out. Before he even fills us up, I'd be totally happy with that. Not because I don't love our church, but it's not about Valley Harvest. It's about the kingdom of God ruling and reigning in Chowchilla. And if I had to work my heart out just for the sake of other churches being blessed and bringing the lost into the kingdom, I'll do it. But you know what? Here's the good news is he loves Valley Harvest and he's blessed us here. And he's given us plenty of empty seats, has he not? My friends, maybe it's time to start inviting some people. If you're too afraid to share the gospel with them, maybe you can get them to come to church. What's it say? Hey, you know, I go to this church and this is what I'm doing Sunday. You want to come with me? My friends, are you an acquaintance of God or are you his close friend? Jesus loves you and he died for you. I'm going to ask the worship team to come. I'm going to ask that you would stand with me. Perhaps God has put it on your heart today that you should be interceding for others. Perhaps today is a day that you need to pray for that special somebody. I know some people we've been praying for a long time, longer than 25 years. And we're still waiting for God to crack some hard hearts. But you know what? I still believe he'll do it. So I want to invite you to respond to God. Perhaps today you don't have that love in your heart because you don't know the Lord. Perhaps you've only been his acquaintance. Well, today, may I introduce you to the Lord of glory, the one who wants to live inside of you and be tight with you like that. I'm going to invite you to come forward as you need. Team, go ahead and lead us in worship.
Savior say, thy strength into the small child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it by a stone. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone, and change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sing and win. And when before the throne I stand in incomplete, Jesus died my soul to save. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Divine is still.
still white as snow. Let's sing, oh praise the one.
Oh praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead.
Give our offering. God, I just pray that it would be a blessing to this city, it would be a blessing to the community, that, God, that our offering, that our gift to you is just a gift that you've already given to us, and we just give back to you. In Jesus' name, amen. You can remain standing. We're going to sing one last song. Water you turned into wine.
Water you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. And into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you.
Sing, our God is greater.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Into the darkness.
Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. And our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, and our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God.
Out together.
And if our God is for us, And who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against? God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power, our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against?
Amen.
But don't forget, God is with us. And don't forget that everything that happens in your life happens for a reason. So as opportunities come this week, I pray that you will see the Lord's hand in each of them, even when they're difficult. So trust him. Trust him and recognize he'll be your friend. The question is, what kind of friend you're going to be to him? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this day. God, we thank you for the way you bless us. God, thank you for the rain. Even though, God, it gets our hair wet, we thank you that you take care of us. To provide for us. God, we pray you keep our eyes open for the opportunities that you will lay at our feet this week. Holy Spirit, please do not allow us to pass those opportunities by without recognizing your hand in it. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you for being here.